Nathan For You is one of the best series on TV at the moment. If you've not seen it, the show follows business expert Nathan Fielder as he offers ridiculous advice to struggling businesses under the guise of a serious documentary series. There are lots of things that we could discuss when talking about the series, not least the questionable ethics behind setting up well-meaning business owners, but by far the most interesting thing about the series is the way in which Fielder and his team engage with the real world. The show isn't just about tricking its contributors, but also us, the viewer, and in a climate in which we are constantly bombarded by hoaxes, online pranks, and
fake news,
Nathan For You gets us to ask a very simple question. What does real actually mean? A typical episode of Nathan For You involves a business owner approaching Fielder and asking him to turn their business around. For example, the episode Burger Joint involves Nathan trying to turn around LA Burger by employing a promotional deal, in which if customers do not believe that the food is the best burger in Los Angeles, they can have their money back. Nathan gives the owner numerous opt-outs from his plan, but the owner is insistent that his product really is the best in LA. This all culminates in a radio talk show, which goes as well as you might expect.
KLOS. Come over, try our burgers. If you don't like it, it's gonna be $100 bill.
Wow, that's impressive.
That's a lot of balls, Gustavo. Yeah. $100, because when's this promotion happening?
It's gonna happen today.
Today?
Yeah.
I can't wait to hear how it turns out.
All right.
And I trust him because I haven't actually tried the burger. I don't eat red meat right now.
What?
So,
what?
I mean, when he says it's the best, I believe that it's the best.
Okay.
There is a crucial difference between Nathan For You and other popular prank shows in that, unlike something like, say, Son, Sex and Suspicious Parents, broadcast on BBC Three some years ago, there is no reveal at the end of the episode to indicate that the contributors have been pranked. Instead, throughout the process, contributors legitimately believe that Fielder's tactics, no matter how left Fielder, will genuinely result in their businesses growing stronger. As Nathan Fielder noted in a Reddit Ask Me Anything, the show's production team goes out of their way to ensure that contributors never find out that they've been pranked. As outlandish as they are, Fielder's ideas often prove quite successful, such as when Nathan convinced a cleaning business to offer a speed service in which 40 maids would clean someone's house in 6 minutes. This makes the show seemingly more authentic than its more staged counterparts. The reaction of the contestants are genuine all the way through to the end, and it is only when the show actually airs the contestants are made aware that they have been featured on a comedy show. This careful line between authenticity and the reality format structure extends to Fielder himself, who plays a supposedly exaggerated version of himself, in a similar fashion to someone like Larry David in Curb Your Enthusiasm. Unlike David, however, this persona extends to all of his interactions with the media, and we are never sure whether Fielder is simply awkward or playing a character.
Absolutely. What do you think of Jim? He's such a great guy for hosting here, huh? And he's single. Ladies, I don't know. You interested in any of them? Or?
You're very kind, but they did all the hard work. They did deserve the applause. They really did a good job.
If you're lucky,
you
he could do some hard work on you.
None of this is particularly groundbreaking in of itself. There have been shows that have treaded the line between reality and scripted. But as the series progressed, the show began experimenting by not only finding ways to trick its contributors, but also its audience. The episode Dumb Starbucks marked the start of this trend, in which Nathan is brought in to help struggling coffee shop, the Helio Cafe, and concocts a scheme to bring more customers through the door. The plan: rebrand the Helio Cafe as Dumb Starbucks, a coffee shop that looks identical to Starbucks, albeit with the word dumb in tiny letters, so that customers mistake the business for an actual Starbucks. The success of the scheme hinges on the manipulation of parody law, as Fielder argues that by including dumb in the title, the Helio Cafe can avoid being sued, because, on a technicality, the business is parodying Starbucks, and so is free to use its imagery. During production of the episode, Dumb Starbucks exploded in popularity, due in part to a false rumour that the project was the work of street artist Banksy, with some customers claiming to have stood in lines for upwards of an hour to visit the site. Fielder held a press conference announcing that Dumb Starbucks was the work of his show, before the coffee outlet was shut down by the Los Angeles County Department of Health Services. In exploiting the media to make Dumb Starbucks appear, as it were, for all intents and purposes, the work of an artist or satirist, Fielder revealed mass media's fallibility. In presenting one of his stunts as real and allowing the media to cover it authentically, he had uncovered a problem with local and national news. This bears relation to theorist Jean Baudrillard's concept of simulation. For Baudrillard, the difference between authentic reality and constructed reality is non-existent. Imagine you suffer from a cold, your nose runs, you struggle to breathe, and you cough constantly. Now consider a hypochondriac, whose symptoms replicate yours due to their own illness. To the naked eye, both you and the hypochondriac exhibit the same symptoms. And whilst out of the two of you, only one person genuinely has the cold, the reality of both of your situations is identical. However, Baudrillard's argument is not about illness, but concerns how this phenomenon translates to the world of mass media. In a world of seemingly infinite content, constant news and conflicting sources, it becomes very difficult to tell the difference between news based in truth and the news heightened for entertainment purposes. Moreover, as truth constantly fluctuates in the world of breaking news, it is possible for seemingly legitimate news sources to be legitimised at a later date, meaning that, in effect, all news can be considered both fake and real. In this sense, Dumb Starbucks demonstrated the fragility and instability of mass media. Whilst at the time networks covered it as a potentially serious business or artistic manoeuvre, in showing us, post the fact, how he had manipulated the idea as a way of drawing attention to the Helio Cafe, Fielder demonstrated how one of his elaborate, fake constructs could be picked up sincerely by the media as a real news story. Another example of this is in the Series 3 episode, The Movement, in which Nathan helps a removal company by trying to create an exercise craze called The Movement, based around lifting and moving furniture, which will not only eliminate labour costs, but allow the business to profit as people pay the removal company to exercise. To do this, Fielder runs an aggressive media campaign centred around the fake story of Jack Garbarino and his miraculous weight loss through his following of The Movement. To do this, he enlists the help of a real ghostwriter to quickly draft up a book based around Jack's life and embellish his backstory.
You know, for my own due diligence, I need to know you're a good writer before hiring you, obviously.
Yeah.
So can you come up with an original sentence right now and tell it to me?
Okay. Okay. The candles flickered, the sheets were still, but all the energy in the room surrounded Roman and Kinsey. Kinsey stepped forth and gently touched Roman's arm. He suddenly felt weak in his legs and trembled and fell, as if his Achilles heel had been struck by a blade, but all it was simply a woman's touch.
Wow. That's a good sentence.
Thank you.
The book quickly became a success and made its way onto the Amazon bestseller list, and Jack was soon the subject of many local news pieces, who were fascinated by his weight loss, fitness regime, and his purported childhood friendship with Steve Jobs.
You also came across Steve Jobs.
Yes.
How did you meet him?
Well, I grew up with him as a child.
No kidding.
He was my best friend as a child.
Strange thing is, as far-fetched as it seems, this stunt actually worked. People bought the book, Fielder was able to recruit people for a taster session, and Garbarino did achieve a small amount of recognition from his TV appearances. At the same time, Fielder had also illuminated the fakeness of numerous fad diets, special exercise programs, and celebrity weight loss videos. Garbarino's book, in telling a ghost-written story, was no different from the plethora of embellished celebrity biographies that are published annually. Likewise, whilst Garbarino's exercise program was entirely fake, was this story any different to numerous weight loss celebrity miracles, which we had later found out were the result of surgery? The mechanisms behind this forgery were transparent due to their reveal on Fielder's show, but prior to the episode's broadcast, the participating parties of the show were none the wiser to the movement's fraudulent results. The simulated nature of this fake workout plan was identical to any other fraudulent workout plan. The difference was that Fielder had revealed the mechanics behind the fakery. The concept reached its apex in season 4's The Interview, which focuses on Nathan's interview on Jimmy Kimmel, which took place 6 months prior to the episode's broadcast. At the time of the interview, Fielder told an anecdote involving an oversized suit, which left Kimmel and the audience in hysterics. Comments flooded in about the hilarity of Fielder's anecdote from YouTube's commenters, and it was obvious that many fans of the show felt that Fielder had aced one of his largest television appearances to date. And then the episode aired. In the episode, Nathan revealed that his interview had been an elaborately constructed ruse, a fake story which had not only fooled Kimmel and his production team, but also his fan base. The episode begins with Fielder lamenting his ability to perform well on televised talk shows, and after studying hours of footage, he constructs what he believes is a formula for the perfect talk show anecdote, which involves a luggage problem, being pulled over by law enforcement on the way to a wedding, and a hilarious mix-up involving drugs. To avoid his story being purely fiction, Fielder then goes to great efforts to ensure the events in his anecdote happen, deliberately mixing up his luggage with a volunteer from Craigslist, hiring a real cop to pull him over, albeit in a road closed for filming, and acquiring a pair of a stranger's mother's ashes so that they can be mistaken for drugs. The extent of Fielder's fakery resulted in the anecdote being a success, but what Fielder couldn't have accounted for was preceding guest Kirsten Dunst, who tells a near identical anecdote which gives his theory complete authenticity. The episode then ends with a montage of numerous talk show interviews, all following the exact same formula. What Nathan For You demonstrated here was that, despite its construction, Fielder's anecdote registered in an identical manner to Dunst's, following the exact same structure, plot beats, and punchline. In watching the audience's responses to both, we see Baudrillard's concept of simulation in practice. Whilst the underlying structures of both anecdotes are different, or at least we are led to believe that Dunst's story did happen, at a surface level, they are identical. Reality and falsified reality become interchangeable and provoke an identical reaction from audiences. It's not just through the media by which Fielder engages with this concept of simulation. As we have seen across the show, Nathan regularly recruits unwitting members of the public into his hoaxes, who are often hired to perform bizarre tasks as jobs, such as the man who buries one of his burner phones in the episode Andy v. Uber. The best example of this is in the season 4 episode Smoke Detector, in which, trying to pass off a smoke detector as a musical instrument, Nathan puts a band together, and trying to draw attention to one of their songs, leads them to believe that Shell Oil have illegally used their song in one of their promotional videos. The swindle involving the hiring of a man to represent the Shell company so that Nathan can make the ruse convincing. To do this, Fielder posed as a new Shell recruiter, constructed a fake interview space, and then gave instructions to his new employee to host a conference in which members of the public could ask Shell about oil spills. Whilst this job is clearly not with Shell and only exists to provide a segment for the show, the real exchange of cash for labour did take place. The employee was paid real money for what he believed was a real job, and performed tasks in exchange for his labour. Similarly, the conference was attended by actual members of the public, who posed serious questions about Shell's environmental policy, and had them answered by Shell's representative. In this sense, the job that Fielder had his worker do was identical to a real job. Whilst on a structural level it was falsified for a TV show, the job had the same outcomes as legitimate work, and was therefore indistinguishable.
I'm a man. I apologize. Be a man and accept my apology.
No, yeah, I accept
that's
your
all
apology.
I'm asking. That's all I'm asking.
Okay, yeah, no,
asking.
Apology accepted.
Apology accepted?
Yeah.
Thank you. Appreciate you for that.
Yeah.
From his origins as a hidden camera prank show, Nathan For You has transformed into an effective satire of media and audience practices. In displaying the mechanics behind seemingly authentic forms of media and exposing their fraudulence, the show explores the concept of
fake news
better than any other satirical show. In routinely tricking his audience and the public writ large, Fielder has created a format that not only blurs the lines between reality and TV pageantry, but also educates its audience on how the difference between real and false is less clear-cut than it first appears. Ah! If you'd like to see more from Full Fat Videos, don't forget to like, share and subscribe. And of course, keep drinking some Full Fat Milk.